he gave the gun to this Chinese guy and he put it, the gun to me, and he said, if you don't gonna lose tonight, then you're gonna have some real problems.
It's not a nice sight seeing an athlete who thinks he's on top of the world getting dressed down by a mob guy, you know, that maybe had a fifth grade education. And this athlete's a big star, you know, everybody knows who he is, but when the mob guy gets up against him, he's like jello.
You know, unfortunately, I know of cases where an athlete was put in a hospital, you know, or handicapped in a way that he couldn't play the game. It happens.
This program is about the tide of scandals linked to match fixing that is entering sport. There's always been controversy around allegations of corruption, but this new phenomenon of globalized gambling linked to the internet is now the number one danger to the credibility of sports.
Pour la question des paris, le mal est encore plus pernicieux, car il touche directement le jeu.
In this new world, there are gambling monitors beside sporting events in every part of the world, like this Dutch second division soccer game. They report back to the multi-billion dollar Asian gambling market. Some of that money is funneled around the world on other sports events and to other gambling sites. This massive amount of sports betting has helped fuel a wave of corruption scandals around the world.
This is not something that is anything other than an act of betrayal of what we know in sports as a sacred trust.
Corruption scandals have threatened sports in many countries, and in some of those leagues, controversy and scandals are going up, attendance and sponsorship money is going down. It's dangerous, and we will explain how it works and why you do not want anything to do with it.
You know, I'm not going to sugarcoat anything. That life at times is a violent life. And if you had to use the threat of violence or violence itself to get your jobs done, you do it. And, you know, unfortunately, I know of cases where an athlete was put in a hospital, you know, or handicapped in a way that he couldn't play the game. It happens. I'm Michael Francis, and for almost 20 years of my life, I was a made man in the Colombo crime family in New York, one of the five New York La Cosa Nostra families. I was involved in gambling. I had a major gambling operation. When you're involved in that life, some way, somehow, you're involved in gambling. And I had, at any point in time, 12 or 13 bookmakers working for me. Obviously, their targets were always athletes. They're pretty easy to exploit. And, you know, to me, it was great. I mean, great business. I mean, you know, we can get athletes going along with us to compromise the outcome of a game. Terrific, because there was big money in it. So it was major, major business for me. We know in life it says that when you borrow money, you become a slave to the lender. Well, when you're an athlete and you get involved with a gambler, you become a slave to the fixer. It's the same thing. You know, we used to hang out in some of the clubs, you know, in Manhattan, Brooklyn, where a lot of the college teams would come in and play. St. John's, some of the major universities. And a lot of these basketball players would go to the same clubs. They like to hang out. They like to party. Mob guys love to party. We live for that. And we'd get our eye on one or two of the guys and wine them and dine them. Hey, come on over to the table. We're your friends. Sit down. Have a bite to eat. You know, bring a few women over. Give them attention. And these are women that we knew. You know, probably we had something to do at the club most of the time. And you know, you kind of bring this along once, twice, three times, four times. Finally, you set them up for the conversation because we're friends now. Yeah, sit down. Let me talk to you. And I said, listen, you're a smart guy. I'm your good friend. Let me tell you how you're going to make some money. $10,000 in my pocket. Pull it out. Put it on a table in front of them. More money than they ever seen in cash in their life. Once we get it, they get into us, so to speak, then they do whatever they're told to do, and that's it. These are not criminals right off the bat. These are young kids, and it gets into their heads, and eventually they'll come back and say, you know what, I got $20,000, $30,000, $40,000. I can't do this anymore. You know, it's getting to me. You know, thank you very much for the opportunity. And my response was always the same. Excuse me, we had a deal. You don't break your word with me. You got 10 games to go. You're done when I tell you you're done. That's it. Again, there's no love relationship between a mob guy and whoever their player is or their pawn or whoever it is. They're there to make money, and that's it.
My dream as a young boy was to be a professional football player. I think nothing is more great than being a professional football player. You wake up in the morning and smell of the grass, and you can practice on it, and it's a thing that you like to do. It's your hobby that you can put on in your work. So there's nothing greater than that. I was a professional football player for 11 years. I played the national youth teams of Belgium from the age of 14 until 23, and I played in the Belgium and Dutch Premier League. We didn't get our salary for 3 months. They were not paying us, and there came a Chinese guy who wanted to put money in the club. The coach told us that he couldn't buy the club because it was very expensive, because we were at that moment at sixth place. So he said, if we lose some games, we're gonna go down in the tables. So then he can buy the club, because if you go a little bit down, the club gonna be less expensive. So he said, just we have to lose a few games and then he can buy the club and it's gonna be okay then. That was our coach, and he said also that we have to be quiet. We don't have to say to anybody. We didn't think it was something wrong, because it was our coach who told us, so we trusted him. And for us, we just want our salary for the 3 months that we didn't get paid. So, that's how it happened. He gave the gun to the Chinese guy, and he put the gun to me, and he said, if you don't gonna lose tonight, then you're gonna have some real problems. That night we lost the game with 5-1, but even then he was not satisfied. So after each game we had to give the money back that he gave us before the game. And he told us, yeah, it's not a good result, you have to do it next week again. He's a very rich guy, and a guy who can let some things happen. So we have to do it again, and we have to hope that he's gonna go away. At that moment, you know, you are in deep shit.
You ruin your career, you ruin your reputation, and you got a chance of getting physically hurt or killed. If I was an athlete and I had any connection or any approach by a mafia guy, I'd be very concerned, believe me, I would. Mafia guys are not impressed with anybody but themselves. Athletes, politicians, actors, they're just suckers to them. They're not approaching you because they want to be your friend. They're approaching you for a reason. They're approaching you to cultivate you in some way where they can compromise you. Well, if I was an athlete and I'm in a restaurant having a meal, I'm with friends, and some guys come up, and you know, you got that look. If you got that feeling that something's wrong, something's wrong. And again, mobsters, gangsters, they don't do anything for nothing. They're not going to buy you a meal because they're a nice guy. Because you know, as I said prior, they're not impressed with you because you're such a great athlete. So. You know, if I was an athlete and I had that feeling, I'd be polite and say thank you very much, but you know, I can't accept the meal. You know, I can't accept you to pay for this, but it was nice meeting you, and that'd be it.